So, you've never heard of a talking tachometer? Well, you're hearing one now, and I've got a very interesting story to tell you. It all began one morning last summer when my friends George and Harry were heading out for a bass fishing trip. George was sure the bass would be biting. That's George driving the boat, which he likes fine. Except there's a neighbor down the way with an outfit just like George's, and he runs circles around him. But George isn't worrying about that neighbor right now. His mind is on Piney Cove, his favorite fishing spot, and he wants to get there first and stake his claim. And then Harry comes up with what may be bad news. They're being overtaken by another boat, probably headed for Piney Cove too. Sure enough, it's that neighbor with his fishing buddy, and that boat of his is really moving. How do you like that, George says. I tell you, that motor of mine is a lemon. Same size boat, same size motor. And he passes me like I'm tied to the dock. Take it easy, George, or you may have a heart attack. Face it, your neighbor has got a faster rig. So, when George and him come around Piney Point, who do they find fishing in Piney Cove? You guessed it. The neighbor and his buddy. Lots of luck, fellas. Forget it, Harry tells George. It's a big lake, and we'll find another spot. But George is really burning inside. Some of these days, he's gonna take that neighbor down a peg or two. They head for one of Harry's hot spots to try their luck there. It doesn't look as fishy as Piney Cove, but Harry says he's caught them here before. Meanwhile, poor George is still having his problems. Harry suggests he tighten the casting drag, but George just gets another backlash. Meanwhile, his partner has a fish on, and he could use a little help in landing it. But first, George has to get his fish line aboard. That first fish is always a welcome one. It sort of breaks the ice. Unfortunately, George is delayed a bit in getting back into action. But Harry's helpful. Now he tells George he doesn't think he's getting enough wrist action in his cast. So George puts a little more wrist into it, and he gets himself another dandy backlash. This is a beaut. If they gave prizes for birds' nests, this would be a winner. Take heart, George. Everybody has a bad day. And it doesn't help things much when your partner is catching all the fish. There was a moment when George was tempted to shake the fish off the hook, but he resists the temptation and brings the fish aboard. Harry is a bit embarrassed by his partner's run of bad luck, so he tactfully suggests that George try his spinning outfit. He explains that it's a balanced rig with the line, rod, reel, and lure matched. This matched business is a new one on George. But at this stage of the game, he's ready to try anything. His first cast isn't anything to write home about, but he gradually gets the hang of things. Then he has a hit, and it feels like a good fish. In fact, it turns out to be a very good fish. For a time, it looked like the fish might win, but the spinning rig is tough. And finally, a whipped bass comes alongside. And Harry grabs him on the first try. Good thing, too, because George would have pushed him over the side if he had missed. So George graciously accepts congratulations. The matched fishing rig has proven its point, and a real lunker joins the others in the live box. That breaks the ice for George, and Harry's pleased too. The two have a fine day of fishing, but like all good things, it has to end. It's always later than you think when the fish are biting. Meanwhile, Harry had been doing some thinking about George and his problems with the neighbor's boat, and he had an idea he wanted to talk over with George on the way back. Your boating rig may be out of balance, like your fishing tackle was, Harry says. Let's stop by a dealer I know and have him check it out. That was the best idea of the day, because it brought George and my boss Les together. I work for Les, and he's okay. He pays attention to what I tell him. Right away, George tells Les that his outboard is a lemon. Les listens, but doesn't say much. He's heard this story before. He just heads for the tool shed to get me and the toolbox.
And some crank.
That's what I like about Les. He doesn't guess when it comes to checking out the performance of a boat. He goes about it scientifically. He wants to get the facts. I was hoping to get a crack at this rig, because it never sounded quite right when George was running by the place with it. Sounded to me like the engine was laboring. Les wants to check throttle linkage with the motor running.
So check my throttle, baby.
To begin testing. This could be risky with a careless operator.
Certainly could.
But not with Les. George told Les that he usually had three fellas in the boat on his fishing trips. So Les said that was fine, and we'd check out the rig with the normal load aboard. Just as I thought. That motor is really laboring. Best reading I can give it is 4,500 RPMs. That ain't good enough, Les says. He tells George to head back to the dock so we can check the propeller. On the way back, Les asked George what size prop he had on the motor, and George couldn't tell him. He told the dealer he bought it from to put on a speed prop. Whatever size prop, it had taken quite a beating from hitting stumps and logs. Les figured it for a 19-inch pitch when he first saw it, but it turned out to be a 21. No wonder that engine was laboring. I'm surprised it was still running. Like I said before, matching the propeller to the boat is a science, and we may have to try two or three before we get the right one. As a starter, Les puts on a wheel with a 15-inch pitch. Now, my guess is that this isn't enough pitch, but we aren't guessing. We're going to make a test run. George was somewhat surprised when Les told him he could have damaged his engine badly with a 21-inch prop. Burned pistons and scored cylinders can come from overloading the engine with the wrong prop. Just as I expected. 6,000 RPMs, that's too fast. No good, my boss says. So it's back to the dock for a different prop. So now we've got the choice between a 17-inch pitch or a 19. I would have picked the 17-inch. And I was right. That 17-inch prop should put us closer to the magic number, which I happen to know is 5,500 RPMs for this engine. And as Les has said many times, that goes for any boat. Now we should see some performance from this outfit. That's more like it. 5,000, 5,100, 5,200. Not bad. Les likes it too. But he says, back to the dock. I've got one more propeller change to make. The change Les had in mind was to replace the 17-inch aluminum prop with a 17-inch stainless steel, and that makes a lot of sense. When George is hunting bass, he doesn't stop for trees, logs, or stumps, so he really needs this tough SST propeller. Les doesn't expect any change in RPMs, but the boat speed should increase 1 or 2 miles an hour. Still 5250. Now we need to pick up 250 RPMs on the engine. The boat seemed a little bow heavy, so Les decides to kick the motor out another notch. He moved it out 2 holes. That ought to lighten the bow, maybe a little too much. I was afraid of this porpoising. Too much tilt. 1 hole would have been about right. That looks better. We ought to pick up a few RPMs and get a good ride with this setup. Well, we gained another 50 RPMs and a beautiful riding boat. That tilt is right where it ought to be, but we need to pick up another 200 RPMs. Les had another trick up his sleeve, but that means hauling out the boat. He wants to check motor height on the transom. The cavitation plate is better than an inch below the keel. Too much. The propeller is running too deep. I can remember when you practically had to rebuild the transom to jack up the motor an inch or so. Now it's real easy to do. If I were a gambler, I'd say we had picked up better than 100 RPMs just by raising the motor. Les replaces the shroud for the final test run. He wants to check performance under normal running conditions. Good idea. Les tells George that this is the moment of truth as we leave the harbor. I've heard some fellas claim they can tell by the sound of the motor when the rig is running right. Maybe so, but old Tach here can tell you for sure. And I say this outfit is right. 5,500 RPM on the nose. My boss agrees with me. Thanks, old buddy. George and Harry are delighted. They never dreamed they could get this kind of performance. George said he could hardly wait until he meets that neighbor of his out on the lake. And he didn't have long to wait. In fact, it was the very next day when they were returning from Piney Cove. The neighbor had a nice string of fish. But George and his partner had a better one and a faster boat. So long, George says. We'll see you at the dock. Now the neighbor's unhappy. And my guess is that he'll be pulling into Les's dock to find out what's wrong with his engine. Maybe we'll have some tackle talk for him. I can tell you that George and Harry are a couple of happy guys, especially George. He got the word from Les, who says, when old Tach here talks, you'd better be listening. Makes me feel kind of good, too.